Hey everybody, good morning, happy Sunday, happy Sunday John, good to see you, brilliant. Guys, it's great to be here, it's great to see you all here. Father God, I thank you that we can meet together this morning to worship you. I thank you that we come this morning, Lord God, as children of you. Lord God, wow, that is amazing that we can come before you, that we can petition you as children of you, that we can worship our Heavenly Father together with one accord to give you praise, glory, and honor in the midst of everything that's going on. Come on. Hallelujah. It's great to be here this morning with you guys. It's great to see some new faces. It's great to see some faces that I already know. On a practical note, if anybody needs the toilet, head through those double doors, turn right, and on your left, I think there are signs all the way, and you'll find the toilets just there. Children will be heading out to their groups after some time of worship. Let's worship our Heavenly Father together this morning.
Let's stand, everybody.
I will love you, Lord, my Savior. I will love you, Lord, my Savior.
sing that song, I think it takes a lot of faith to say that as I wait, as I wait on the Lord, as I trust in Him, as I kind of take the position of worship and lift my heart, my eyes to Jesus, I can trust that He's the one who's able to make a difference, a tangible difference in my walk, in the week that we have. And I just think this is a faith opportunity for us to come in faith and trust that the promises that Jesus makes to us are true and relevant and real. I wonder if we could just sing that through again and just take it as a promise from God in the reality this morning that as we wait, He can cause us to rise up on wings like eagles. We can run and not grow weary and walk and not be faint. Bless you, guys.
Thank you.
Father God, I thank you that you are our rock, our refuge, that even when things around us change and seem so uncertain, that you are steadfast, that you are immovable and unchanging, that we can put our trust in you, that Jesus, we can look to you, our lighthouse, and that you guide us, direct us, that you are a thing of safety. We thank you, Jesus, we worship you. Amen.
Amen.
Fantastic. Okay, children, would you like to stand up? Stand up. And if you know where you're going, then the older children, school-aged children, are going to head out through those double doors at the back. And younger than school-aged children are going to head through these doors over here. Father God, I pray that you have blessed the children this morning, that you have blessed the adults who are leading the children groups, that they would know you and meet with you in such a real way today. Amen. Fantastic. It's a real blessing and a real privilege that we can meet together in this large hall, that we have space and freedom to stretch out and that we're not cramped. It's a real blessing that we can meet in this school. And I just want to spend a few moments to just pray for this school. As children have gone back to school recently, Father God, I just thank you that we can meet in Brookfield School. I thank you, Lord God, that we can meet here and that we can worship you and glorify you and lift your name up on high in this assembly hall, in this hall here. Lord God, I pray that we'd be claiming this atmosphere for you. That if there are any strongholds or principalities of darkness and tough times, Lord God, I just pray that they would be broken as we worship you this morning. That as we meet together and as we look at your word, Lord God, and know your peace and your Holy Spirit, that we would just claim freedom from bullying and depression, freedom from always speaking down on other people, Lord God, that we would break those strongholds, I pray, over children in this school, that children would just experience, Lord God, you, I pray, and they may not know it, they may not know what is different, but as they come in tomorrow, or Tuesday, or whenever it is they're coming in, just pray, Lord God, that they would tangibly sense something different, that there wouldn't be putting their peers down, but actually there would be speaking truth and life to each other, that there would be building up of each other, that there would be an encouraging of each other. Lord God, I pray that those who have been feeling depressed or anxious or fearful in any way, I pray, Lord God, that that would be broken and taken away completely. That in its place there would be peace and joy and laughter, Lord God. Lord God, I pray, I'm sure there are children who haven't laughed in a long time, and that just breaks my heart. And Lord God, I just pray that you would place your heart on our heart, that these children, Lord God, would just experience laughter and joy and release and freedom. In your name, Jesus, for your glory. Amen. I know that tomorrow is a sad day for many, as there's a bank holiday and it is the Queen's funeral tomorrow. And I'm sure there are going to be millions and millions of people who will be watching that, and effectively the church service of her funeral. And I'm just reminded of something that my mum sent to me in a WhatsApp message, actually, when we heard that the Queen had passed away. And it was the Queen saying, "I so long for Jesus to come back in my lifetime." And someone says, "Why?" And she says, "So that I may lay my crown at his feet." Wow. Every Queen's speech at Christmas time, I really felt that she so clearly shared her heart and her love for Jesus. That she always said that Jesus is where she draws her faith from and her strength from. And but I just want to spend a few moments here just to, whatever your feelings, whatever your thoughts are, just to spend a few moments in quiet thought, praying for the Queen, for her family during this time. Whether you're mourning, whether you know people who are mourning. Father God, I thank you for a monarch who, for so many years, faithfully served nations and peoples. But Lord God, I believe in her quiet time in behind closed doors, faithfully served you. Lord God, I pray that you would just bless her family, give strength and peace to her family. And I pray, Father God, that they would be reminded and think to her faith in you. And especially tomorrow as they have the funeral, that you would be glorified in that, Lord God. That your name would be spoken and that there would be light in that time of sadness. That there would be a hope and a faith that, Lord God, is put in you, that is not misplaced, but that is put in you, and that her faith and her love for you would just really be shown tomorrow and witnessed by many. Father God, I thank you that, she is at peace now. Just pray that you bless her and bless her family, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to invite Tom up. Tom is speaking and sharing with us this morning. I'll say that again. I'm excited. I want to encourage you to be excited. I'll leave you into a little secret. I heard there might be a video. So, you know, when that video was wheeled out at school lessons, do you remember the excitement in that? Anyway, yeah. Tom is going to be speaking with us this morning, sharing with us. I'm really excited for that. I pray that God would just bless each of us as Tom shares this morning, that Tom would be so blessed as he shares, oh God. And as he has been preparing what he's going to share with us this morning, and as it's been laying on his heart, oh God, I pray that it would just speak directly to our hearts, oh God, that we would understand what he's saying, and oh God, that your Holy Spirit would just really minister to us this morning. Father God, we pray. Bless Tom. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone. We're in Mark chapter 1 this morning. We're still doing our series called This Is Jesus, looking at the story and the life of Jesus. We've got the words on the screen, so we're going to go straight to Mark chapter 1. And we're going to read verses 14 to 28. And it says, "Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee, proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, 'The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel.' Passing along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, 'Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men.' And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boat, mending the nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and followed him. And they went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath he entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority, and not as the scribes. And immediately there was in the synagogue a man with an unclean spirit. And he cried out, 'What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God.' But Jesus rebuked him, saying, 'Be be silent and come out of him. And the unclean spirit convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice came out of him. And they were all amazed. So they questioned amongst themselves, saying, what is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits and they obey him. And at once his fame spread everywhere throughout all the surrounding region of Galilee. Amen. 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 Guys, to begin with, I've got a little challenge which involves eating a Mars bar. So, would anyone like to volunteer for eating a Mars bar? Cal? Come on, catch. Anyone else? Yeah, bless you, Barry. Warm. There's a caveat though. Anyone else? Mars bar? It is always the men, that's still worthy. On you, little brother, bless you. Anyone else? Ed? That was close. There are more. Anyone else interested?
I don't trust you.
Great. All right, just put your hand up if you've got one. All right, the challenge is simple. You just got to eat it. What we're going to say is, these guys over here, you've got to eat it, but you've got to eat the caramel first. Okay? Barry and Paul, you've got to eat it, but you can only eat the nugget first. And on Yilo, you've got to eat it in exactly 31 bites. Okay. You've got 30 seconds while I get my notes ready. So 30 seconds. 3, 2, 1, go. You can't eat the chocolate's cheating. Oh, very good. Cheating is a good option. Great, well done. Good sports. Did anyone manage it? Did anyone manage it? You did it, Ed. No. Oh, well done for having a go. You're very welcome to it, yes. You can eat in whatever form you like. Right, there is a point somewhere. What we're thinking about today is something that's probably quite countercultural in many respects. We're going to be thinking about the word authority. And in our society, we live with various degrees of authority. There are various rules and laws in our society, and most of us keep them most of the time. And there are a variety of reasons for that. Maybe you keep the laws because, you know, you have a heart that rejoices in the law. Maybe you keep it because you're a good person who feels that's the right thing to do. Maybe you keep the law because you're afraid of the consequences. There are a whole variety of reasons that we keep the law. But fundamentally, how laws work in this society is there is a law given, and then we are the ultimate deciders on whether we obey it or not. We've got the choice to obey or not. That's the framework that we have in this society. That's how authority works, and that's how we perceive it. Just a bit like those Mars bars, I give people various rules, but ultimately, at the end of the day, it's the individual person who's going to decide whether to eat it or not, to eat the caramel or not, and that's how we view authority. And then, in this passage that I don't know if you picked up, it talks about Jesus' authority a whole bunch of times, and they're amazed at his authority, because it's fundamentally different to that. And so we have this weird kind of story where Jesus is in the synagogue, a bit like this, there's a worship service happening, and a man stands up and starts shouting. And Jesus casts out a demon, and they're all amazed at his authority. Because in that moment, Jesus doesn't offer a suggestion to the demon that then he decides to agree to and come out. His authority is different. He speaks, and it happens. And that's what's amazing. That's what they can't comprehend. They've never seen anything like it. that Jesus speaks, and then because he spoke, it happens. And we see this all the way through the book of Mark. We see in the next story, Jesus goes and heals Peter's mother-in-law. And in a word, Peter's mother-in-law is healed. And then the next story is a whole group of people come to him, a whole village come to him, and he speaks and heals them. And he casts out a variety of demons just by speaking. And then in the middle of that story, what happens is that some of the demons come to him and they ask his permission to speak, and he says no. That's the level of his authority. One evening he's asleep on a boat and his disciples wake him up, and he speaks to the wind and the waves, and the wind and the waves recognize the voice of the Creator and they cease immediately. Another time he's in a place and a demoniac comes to him with a whole army of demons inside of him, and they have to ask Jesus permission to come out of the man and go into some pigs. That's the authority that we're dealing with. A woman comes to Jesus with an issue of blood, and one of the saddest sentences in the New Testament, it says that she spent all of her money on physicians, but instead of getting better, she grew worse. But she knew that if she had one touch, one contact, one encounter with Jesus, that would change everything. We don't see in the New Testament Jesus engaging in an epic battle between darkness and light. We don't see an epic engagement between Jesus and the forces of Satan. He comes and in his authority, he speaks and things happen. And that's what's amazing, and that's what people don't comprehend. And in a way we don't comprehend, because this Jesus that we see in the book of Mark is still the same Jesus that we come to today. He's still the same Jesus who rules over the nations. He's still the same Jesus who saves and forgives and heals and by his word calls people to himself. He has the same authority. And what we're thinking about today is Jesus' authority. But what's striking is the way that he expresses his authority. Because he doesn't express his authority in the way that many of us would. He expresses it through his compassion. He expresses it through his kindness. And he expresses it, we look at three ways today. He expresses it in his teaching. He expresses it in his making of disciples. And he expresses it in his healing and his reaching out to the last, the least, and the lost of the world. And that's how we see that Jesus expresses his authority. I was reading a commentary this week by a guy called Mark Yarborough, and he says, one of the telling things about Jesus' authority is that it leaves people with a sense of awe and wonder and fear. And that's my goal this morning, is that we see Jesus afresh and go away with a sense of awe and wonder and fear at who Jesus is and what he's able to do. Another guy called John Stott says, no one in the New Testament ever comes to Jesus and goes away with a lukewarm response. Some of them hate him. Some of them want to kill him. Some of them betray him. Some of them are frustrated by him. Some of them love him. Some of them worship him. But no one goes away lukewarm. And it's really easy sometimes to come to these stories in Mark, maybe some of us have heard dozens and dozens of times before, and to come at it with fresh eyes and a fresh heart, to feel afresh the authority that Jesus has in our present world, in our lives. So we're going to look at these three things. We're going to look at Jesus and his teaching, his authority and his teaching, Jesus and his authority making disciples, and Jesus and his authority healing and reaching out to the lost. And so the first thing we see is Jesus as a teacher. And what is interesting here is there's this kind of phrase, isn't there? Maybe you picked it up, where it says they were surprised and amazed at his teaching because he taught with authority and not like the scribes. And what's interesting, at least I find interesting, is in the synagogue there probably would have been a bunch of scribes there in the presence of them saying that, and the people are saying, this guy doesn't teach like those guys over there. He has authority. It's a bit of a funny phrase, so I thought what I'd do is I'd read an excerpt from something called the Talmud, which is a record of what these scribes would teach, and you can get a vibe of what a Sunday morning sermon would look like when there was a scribe. And I don't mean, I'm not trying to make fun of this, but it gives you an insight into the difference between, many of you have heard Jesus' teaching, and you can hear what scribes' teaching would sound like, and you can compare. So, it's quite long, so excuse that. And it's a teaching about eating eggs on the Sabbath. And it says, Rabbi Mishnah says, an egg laid on a festival can be eaten if it's eaten on the same day that it was laid. So say the school of Shammai, and the school of Hillel, however, say that it must not be eaten on a Sabbath. Rabbi Gemara says, to what kind of hen does this refer? If it's a hen whose purpose is for eating, then why does the school of Hillel prohibit the eating of the egg? If so, then the school of Shammai will be in accordance with Rabbi Simeon, who denies that you can eat eggs on a Sabbath. But the school of Hillel will be in accordance with Rabbi Jehuda, who encourages egg eating on a Sabbath. Now, if the Mishnah means a hen, which is kept for laying eggs only, and the reason that it is prohibited is because the egg is not laid on the Sabbath, then why do they differ in regards to eating the hen itself? Therefore, said Rabbi Rabba, the Mishnah refers to a hen kept for eating and to a festival after a Sabbath, but not on the Sabbath itself. And the teaching of the school of Hillel is not for this reason, but instead refers to the preparation of eggs the day before. And you can see it goes on like this. This document, the Talmud, is actually 12 times longer than our New Testament. And it's full of stuff like that. So it's not a great quote. There's plenty of quotes and better quotes out there. But it gives you an insight, maybe, into the kind of temperature, what's happening on an average synagogue Sunday, that kind of reading, that kind of sermon. And then Jesus comes along, and he delivers his sermon and his message, and has this this moment where he casts out a demon. And it's quantifiably different, isn't it? That's the point I want you to see. I've even got a quote from Queen Elizabeth as well this morning, so I'm doing very well. Maybe you've seen this, it's been doing the rounds on Facebook. It's a quote about Christmas, because she often spoke about Christmas, didn't she? So forgive the kind of Christmas language, but it says, it is the simplicity of the Christmas story that makes it so universally appealing. Simple happenings that form the starting point of the life of Jesus, a man whose teachings have been handed down from generation to generation, and have been the bedrock of my faith. There's something, isn't there, about the teaching of Jesus that is both timeless, powerful, unique, and intrinsic. It calls out, and when we hear truth, it resonates with our heart, and we hear truth when we hear Jesus speak. Amen. And when Jesus speaks, we hear his authority. I've been reflecting just recently on a really interesting story in John 7. And in John 7, the scribes and the Pharisees send some hardened military guys to go and arrest Jesus. And they come back after trying without Jesus, and the priests and the scribes ask them where Jesus is. And they say, we couldn't get him because no one ever spoke like this man. And I thought, what an interesting phrase on the lips of hardened military men. No one ever spoke like this man. Because when you hear the teaching of Jesus, it's unlike anything else. For example, Jesus in John chapter 8, he claims to have existed before he was born. He says, before Abraham was, I am. He claims to be the only way to the Father. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. He claims in John 6 and 10 to be the bread of life that gives us eternal life. In John 11, he claims to be the very person who has the power to raise us up on the last day and give us resurrection life. In John 17, he claims to be the very glory itself that will satisfy our souls forever. No one ever spoke like this man. And we see in this story, Jesus shows his authority through what he says, through his teachings. And then the first story we have is quite interesting. It's Jesus' first ever message. I'm going to read it to us again in a second. But what we see here is Jesus as a good news herald. He's a herald of the good news. And this is in verse 14 and 15. It says, now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. That's Jesus' kind of first message. And what's interesting is, what Jesus is doing here is a role that would have existed in the ancient world. So in the ancient world, when an event happened, particularly a military victory or a new emperor was born, what would happen is that they would send out these emissaries, these messengers, and they would go and proclaim this message, and they would use this same Greek word that Jesus uses. It's translated gospel or good news or glad tidings or reasons to celebrate. The word is euangelion, and this word would have had connotations in the ancient world, because what would happen is that word would be used by these missionaries, these emissaries, when an event in history happened that led to a change in circumstances and status for the hearers. So if a great battle was won, they'd send out these people and they'd proclaim this message, good news, gospel, euangelion, a great victory is won, therefore you're no longer a slave, you're free. Or good news, a new emperor has started, a new emperor's here. Good news, you're in a new kingdom. And so this word would mean an event in history has happened, and because of that, that's led to a change in status for you who hear it. And Jesus takes this word and uses it by himself and says, there's an event in history that's happened for those who put their faith and their trust in it. There is a change in status for those people. And we see it, an event in history, Jesus' death and resurrection, which means that we, as those who believe in that event, have a change in status. We're no longer slaves, we're free. We're no longer captives, we're sons and daughters. We're no longer dead, we're alive. We're no longer guilty and under God's wrath, but we're forgiven and free and renewed and restored. An event in history takes place, which leads to a change in status for us. And this is what Jesus is doing. He's going and he's proclaiming this message of good news. Interestingly, in the ancient world, when those messages were sent out, the word was only ever used in its plural form. So whether they would send out the message, it would be gospels, or good newses, or reasons to celebrate. But in the New Testament, it's always singular. It's the good news of Jesus, because there is only one good news, and there is only one way to the Father, and there is only one route to salvation, and that's in and through the work of Jesus. And that's his message that he goes around and gives to people. He says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Look to me and find salvation. And he says in this message, repent and believe. We're going to have communion later, and that's the foundation of how we come to communion. We repent, we confess our sins, we confess our failures, we confess our need for Jesus, and we believe afresh in who he is, his work, his power, his grace. And Jesus shows his authority to us today by revealing himself afresh and showing himself to us as we come to meet with him. So the first way Jesus shows his authority is through his teaching. The second is through his raising up of disciples. And this is a really, probably really familiar story, isn't it? Where Jesus goes to Peter, James, John, and Andrew and says, follow me. And what struck me as I was praying about this passage is that long before Jesus ever came to these men and called them to leave their father's boats and follow him, he himself left his father's throne and came to earth. There's a hymn, isn't there? He left his father's throne above. So free, so infinite is grace. And it's easy. We're going to talk a bit about the cost of discipleship. But it's helpful, I think, before we do, to think and remember that our discipleship cost God far more than it will ever cost us. But still, he goes to these men, and he says to them the same thing that he says to us. He says, follow me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. If you've got the NIV in front of you, I want to suggest that the translation there isn't very helpful, because it says in the NIV, follow me, and I will send you out to fish for people. But I like the ESV, because it talks about two things. It talks about a promise and a purpose. In the ESV, or some other translations, it says, follow me, and I will make you to become fishers of men. There's a promise and a process attached to that. Jesus says, follow me, and I will make you. I will work in your life. I will feed into your life. I will call you through a process. So in that way, I will make you into something. I will make you to become fishers of men. And I love that promise that as we follow Jesus, he's the one who does the work for us. I was reading a book by Philip Yancey, and he has this great illustration about discipleship. And he talks about a college basketball game in America, which I'm guessing most of us probably don't know that much about. But he gives this example of a college basketball game, and what happens often is that this entire series of basketball games, this competition, comes down to one game, and that one game often comes down to one point. And there's a young lad there, normally, who has to make a shot, and if he makes the shot, the team win. But if he misses the shot, the team don't win. And that's often how these finals play out. And he's telling the story about watching this television game, and that event is playing out in front of him. And there's a lad there who's got to make the shot, and if he makes the shot, his team wins. And if he misses the shot, his team loses. And you can see on his face all of these anxieties and worries going through his face, all the potential, you know, the newspapers, the headlines, the NBA career, all that kind of stuff, potential, but also the other potential, the fear, the worry, the anxiety about missing. I don't know about you, but I remember growing up and watching England football, Euro 96. I can't remember people who scored the penalty, but I can remember that Gareth Southgate missed. And there's potential, there's fear. And Philip Yancey paints that picture. And then in the story, Philip Yancey has a phone call, pops out of the room to take a phone call, and comes back. And the picture on the screen has completely changed. Now it's a picture, there's ticker tape and confetti and noise and music, and this lad is on his teammate's shoulders and they're all celebrating. And obviously he'd made the shot. But he says there's two pictures of discipleship. And he asks the question, which picture is your discipleship more like? Is it based on fear, on performance, on anxiety, on will I make it or not, will I do it or not? Or is it based on joy and celebration and victory and assurance? And he paints that picture and asks us, what does our discipleship look like? And Jesus' promise here is, you follow me and I will make you into something. I will put you in a process. I will make you to become fishers of men. And I love that language of Jesus. He's calling us into a process. And then that language of fishers of men is really interesting as well. I don't know if you know this, but in the Bible, in Hebrew thought, the ocean or the sea or water is often a picture or a metaphor for the kingdoms of darkness, for humanity, for fallenness, for rebellion, for self-kingdom, for self-reliance. It's a metaphor for everything bad with the world. And what Jesus is saying is we can be a part of a process that gets people out of that and into something else. It's a fishing of men out of brokenness and self-love and everything wrong and sinful in the world. It's fishing people out of that and bringing them into something else. It's taking people out of the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of light. It's taking people out of wrath and condemnation and into a fresh sense of hope and faith. And we get to be a part of that process. I'm just going to talk you through something that I find really helpful when we're thinking about discipleship. And it's a journey, I'm going to call it the redemptive edge. It's a journey that Jesus takes us on as disciples. And often, when Jesus takes us on a journey as a disciple, he starts by taking us out of our comfort zone. And comfort's good, isn't it? Everyone likes comfort. This morning, I clicked the snooze button on the alarm, and it feels so good. I just thought as I was lying there, man, if I could monetize the snooze button, I would be set. Because there's something so satisfying about staying in comfort. But you can't stay there, can you? You can't just stay in comfort, because if you stay in comfort, nothing ever happens. So in our Christian journey, Jesus calls us out of comfort. And often, as we start to step out of comfort, we start to hear notes of caution around us as we press on with Jesus. So for example, when I became a Christian, my dad, who's not a Christian, he said to me, Tom, that's fine, but don't get carried away. Everything in moderation. You know, you can do that, but don't let it get you. I mean, maybe you've had those words of caution as well. Don't get too carried away. But often, as you press on with Jesus, that caution changes into concern. I remember my dad in a conversation 6 months later, he really thought that I'd joined a cult, which is worrying because now he thinks I lead a cult. But people, as you press on to Jesus, start to get into this note of concern. Oh, are you sure that's a good idea? Are you sure it's a good idea to give your money away to a church? Are you sure it's a good idea to go to that prayer meeting? Are you sure it's a good idea? And when we press on past concern, often we get to the point of criticism. And I don't know if you've ever been criticized for your faith, but it's a hallmark of Jesus' ministry. It's a hallmark of what Jesus does in the Gospels, is he regularly is criticized. And as we press on to Jesus, I believe Jesus' ultimate destination for us is to press into the darkness. Jesus is the light of the world. We're called to be lights of the world. We're called to go into the darkness. And the light isn't afraid of the degree of darkness that it's put in. In fact, the light shines brighter if it's put into a greater degree of darkness. And what I want to say to you is that line, I've called it the redemptive edge. That's the line where Jesus loves to show up and work. That's the place where Jesus does his ministry. Interestingly, I often want the line to be there. Just outside of comfort, just outside of the bed, that's where I want Jesus to work. But often in Jesus' ministry, that's where he does his work. You know, so Jesus, he eats with sinners regularly, doesn't he? He's criticized for it. Jesus regularly spends time with women, which in his society at his time was something that led to a lot of criticism. And he entrusted them with a lot of responsibility. He entrusted them as witnesses to the resurrection. Many of them supported his ministry themselves, but it was a source of criticism. He was criticized for his approach to rules and the religious practices of the day. He was criticized for his calling of sketchy disciples. I was thinking about this and, you know, it's probably a fair criticism of Jesus today that he tends to call the sketchiest of people to come and follow him. He's criticized for his approach to the adulterous woman. He was criticized for his approach to the family. He said that those who were his mothers and sisters and brothers were those who obeyed his word. And he was criticized for a variety of things. And then another hallmark of Jesus' mission is that he spent time in the darkest and the hardest places. So he went to Samaria, a place where Jewish people wouldn't even go. But there he had remarkable outpourings. He spent time in the Decapolis, which for the Jews was a place where they felt like all of the Canaanites from the Promised Land went to live. It was a dark place. He went to the demoniacs, he went to the sinners, the tax collectors, and ultimately in the Great Commission, we see him sending us into the darkest places. In the book of Acts, that's what we see, an unfolding of his disciples spreading into the darkest places. And I believe for us as a church, and for us as individuals, this is the journey that Jesus takes us on. Very rarely does Jesus call people to go down the spectrum into comfort, but he often calls people to step out into criticism and into darkness. I wanted to try and illustrate this with a picture that I found. I just thought it would be really, really good to take a few moments to reflect on this. This is a picture from the Met in New York. And if you can see there, this is just it's a pre-Reformation painting. And what it is you see there a variety of cardinals and bishops sat there, and it's not great lighting, but behind them you can see a painting. That's the flaying of Saint Bartholomew. It's a really famous painting of his martyrdom. And in front of them, almost prophetically, is a group of people who've lost that call to martyrdom-style living, lost the call to pressing on to Jesus, and instead have been taken up with a call to comfort and ease. And then in the middle, there's a priest. And he's there and he's pleading with the cardinals to break out of their structures, their rules, their religion, and press into the mission. And according to the painter, he's just come from the mission field. And as you can see, he's showing them the scars that he's got from being on mission. And he's calling them and asking them and pleading with them to come with him onto the mission field and to reach out with the love of Jesus. And I just thought that was a really interesting picture. A prophetic picture of that redemptive edge, that Jesus similarly calls us out of comfort to step into what he wants us to do. I think what we might do is, we're going to leave that picture on for a second. We're going to celebrate communion in a minute. And I actually had a few more things that I was going to say, but I might stop there because I've gone on a little bit longer than I anticipated. But the reality is, if we claim to be disciples of Jesus, if we have faith in Jesus, he calls us on a journey, he calls us on an adventure, and none of us get it right. None of us are perfect. We all make mistakes. And what we do when we come to communion is we have this opportunity to confess our sins, to ask for forgiveness, but also in faith to recommit ourselves to Jesus and to one another. So I'm going to pray, and we're just going to use this opportunity to confess to Jesus our hearts, to confess to Jesus our sins, just to take a moment, and then Callum's going to come and lead us in a time of communion. Everyone's welcome to come and participate in the bread and in the wine. They signify for us Jesus' body and blood. We remember Jesus' death and resurrection through this meal. Can I invite you up, Callum? As Callum comes, we're just going to take a moment, maybe just reflecting on this picture, and we're just going to take a moment to confess to Jesus in our hearts, through praying. Jesus, we just remember your final words to your disciples on earth were that all authority in heaven and on earth had been given to you. Therefore, go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded. And Father, I just pray now that we realize that we all fall short. We realize that we all make mistakes. We realize that our sin is a serious barrier between us and you. And we thank you for the provision of Jesus Christ, his blood, his death, his resurrection, that through faith in him, we can be cleansed and healed. And so we pray that as we confess our sins, Father, would you come and would you minister forgiveness? In Jesus' name.
Just wanted to share this verse with you from Hebrews. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Just before I invite everybody up, I think this kind of ties in with what Tom was saying, but last night I was driving into Chesterfield, and in the sky, it was about 20 past seven, so it's getting dark, but it was really light at the bottom. And just in the sky, over this direction, over here, I saw this cross. It was lit up so well. And the rest of the sky was starting to get dark, but this was really light. And it just really reminded me that we have been bought by his blood. That this isn't a sign of shame, but that he scorned the shame. And this is a sign of victory, that he is victorious. Can I invite the musicians up a little? Can you play while I invite everybody up to come and have communion? Father God, I thank you that we can come before you with confidence. Because Jesus, you came, you died, and you rose again. That you came as the perfect high priest so that we could come directly to the Father. Confessing our sins, saying sorry, and knowing your mercy and your grace. Father God, we thank you. I invite you to come. It's all gluten-free and alcohol-free, so in your own time, please come. Praise God, praise God. Father God, you are so great. You are so wondrous. You are so mighty and majestic. We just want to fall down at the foot of your throne and worship you. Hallelujah. Thank you that we can. Jesus, we praise you and we worship you. Amen.
Amen.
We're doing something a little bit different. We're going to end with notices. So that's exciting. Before that, I want to welcome Jezza, and he's got something to share. So.
Just as we were praying before for the school, I just got a picture. We were singing the last song before we started the talk, was My Lighthouse. And I just got a picture of this school being a lighthouse in this place right now. And the words were actually being sung to us. We were lifting our praise to God. The people out there were singing to us, my lighthouse, I will follow you, you will lead me safe to shore. And I just felt that was what they were singing to us. And so just be the light where you are. Praise God.
Amen. I think that's something that will always challenge me and is great to be constantly reminded of. And I just want to pray that over each one of us for this week, that wherever we are, whether it's at home, at work, out and about, that we would just know the spirit and the power that is inside of us, that we carry that same authority and that same power and that same light that rose Jesus from the grave. I mean, come on, that we are sons and daughters of the Almighty Living God. Hallelujah! I'm ready to go out now. I'm feeling encouraged and challenged and blessed. And that redemptive line there, you know, sometimes we've got to step out in boldness through faith and out of our comfort. But I pray that this would be a fantastic week and that next week we would meet together with some amazing stories to share. Some amazing accounts of what God has done in this week. So come on, I'm excited, expectant. Thank you for sharing that word. Bless you. Anilo, would you like to come up? And then Tom's got some notices to share.
Hi, everyone. I just wanted to say on the 2nd of October, we'll be stepping away from the role of being the father and mother of faithful, and handing that role over to God, and then we'll be taking up the role of being her caregiver. In other words, what I'm trying to say is that we'll be dedicating faithful on the 2nd of October, and I just want to invite everyone in the church to be part of that celebration. We'll do the dedication here, and then there will be a brief reception, like refreshment at the church in New Street. So I encourage you to, after the church that day, just come over to New Street, and then we'll do a little this thing. And also put on your dancing shoes. Like when we do our dedication, we dance a lot. So just put on your dancing shoes and come over as we dance to the glory of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Excellent. It's the 2nd of October, 2 weeks' time. Do make it an important thing to do. Mary's going to come up and share something with us as well. We may maybe have a video. We'll see.
An initiative that started in Sheffield a few years ago called the Streets of Light, which is a way of spreading God's light in the time running up to the end of October, where people in our country like to celebrate a bit of darkness, and Streets of Light is a way of counteracting that and celebrating light and love and hope. So we can get the video to work and then.
Seems to take grip, with a sparkle of hope that changes things. The Streets of Light is a story for you. Follow the map and wow the view. As the night draws in, let your creation dazzle with love and stars and joy for good measure. Her paper and shapes lights up your window as we walk these streets and the good news continue. For peace and a love that's just for you. So take to the roots and embrace this opportunity to step into hope and a sense of community. What will you see? What will you make? What will your neighbor build and create? Let's burn bright, be the hope and the love. Let our streets become the streets of light. Decorate one or more of your windows in your home and light it up between 4:30 and 9:30. Include the words light, hope, or love in your design. The Streets of Light map will be shared on the website and social media, and you can explore the streets of light.
Previous years in Sheffield, and I thought it would be really cool if we as a church could start it happening here in Chesterfield. It's just a really awesome piece of outreach that literally lights up our streets in the week running up to the 31st of October. So it's very straightforward. You decorate a window, you make sure the light in that window is on for that week running up between 4:30 and 9:30. You sign up on the website, or I can help you if you need that. And then the church in Sheffield who runs it will make a map, and then people can go and look at that map and like go and look at all the windows. So it's a really easy thing to share at like the school gate and kids groups and play groups. Just, yeah, I really like the idea and would love to see it happen in Chesterfield as well. So I don't know if people have connections in other churches as well who might want to share it with their church. I think Tom put in the email a link to the website, so there's a form to sign up there. Or if you want some help with that, I can do that, and I think you can print it out as well. Excuse me.
Thank you. Excellent. Oh, great. Well, it's been great to be together. We're going to have refreshments now, which are kind of served over in that direction. On a practical note, if you've got a communion cup, would you mind just popping it back on the tray? It makes it easier for us to set it down. Otherwise, guys, bless you. See you next week. Have a good week.